Let's get started with semester one, problem solving. And the first question that I would like you to start with is, a relation and function question. So here's the first question for you all. Question is, if E has 1, 2, 3, 4 and F has 1, 2, then the number of onto functions from E to F, there you go. Poll is on. Number of onto functions from E to F. Guys, 1 minute, max 1.5 minutes. That depends upon how many of you have responded to that particular question. No problem, Shritish. Let's get started with problem solving. Okay, 10 people have responded. 30 more seconds I can give. Sure, Raghav. No issues. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, 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 everybody. Okay, just take a guess. Okay, so 24 of you have responded to this question, and maximum people have said option number A. Okay, now this question can be solved in a very simple way. First of all, the total number of functions. So if there is a function from E to F, okay, then the total number of functions, you already know this, will be number of elements in F to the power of number of elements in E. Okay. So in this case, it will be 2 to the power 4, which is 16. But a function will not be onto if any one of the elements of F is left out. That means, let us say I have a situation where all these elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, either all map to 1. Okay. So this will not be an onto function. Or they all map to 2. This will also be not an onto function. In fact, it will be an into function. So what is into function, onto function? Onto means none of the elements of the codomain is left unmapped. That means every element of F is the range or is participating in the range. So these two scenarios will be ruled out. Okay. So subtract 2 from the result. The answer is going to be 14. Option number A. Correct. So if you just link it to your understanding of, let's say, permutation and combination concept. So let's say A has N number of elements, okay? And B has, let's say, R number of elements. So basically what you want to do, you are distributing N distinct balls. So finding the number of onto functions is basically the number of ways to distribute n distinct objects among R different groups such that no blank group is allowed. No blank group is allowed. Okay. If you recall, the number of ways to do this, we had derived in our permutation combination chapter, is R to the power N minus RC1, R minus 1 to the power N, minus RC2, R minus 2 to the power N, plus RC3, R minus 3 to the power N, till it starts becoming 0. In case you want to use a formula, I'm not saying this is a compulsion to use, in case you want to use a formula, So as per our scenario, this is 4, this is 2. So this is 2 to the power 4 minus 2c1. This is 2 minus 1 to the power of 4. This all will be 0, 0. I mean, not required for us. So that will be 16 minus 2, which is 14 again. In case you want to go for a formula. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? But however, the fastest way to solve it is by realizing that total number of functions is 2 to the power 4. Minus 2 will be because if all of them map to, let's say 1, or all of them map to 2, that 2 cases will be removed. Okay. Next. F of x is gif x squared, gif x plus 1 minus 3. Then which of the following option is correct? Relaunch the poll. By the way, they should have actually mentioned the codomain actually, because then only you'll be able to, you know, talk about, okay, let's say the codomain is all real numbers. Let me make this function R to R. Just 11 of you have responded. 1.5 minutes gone. Okay, let me begin the countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. Okay. So if you see in this question, many of you don't read all the options. And most of you have gone for one of the options immediately looking at the first option. See here. Most of you have said option number D, but I can see 4 of you have also said option number A. So this is a message to those 4 of you. Whenever you have like both A and B correct, now you should always give both options a try. Okay. That's why it's very important to scan through all the options, even though you have figured out that one of them is correct initially itself. Now, if you look at the second option number B, it says the function is 0 for infinitely many values of X, which is correct. Actually, if you put a 1, you get 1 plus 2 minus 3, which is a 0. If you put a 1.1 also, so 1.1 GIF is 1, so 1 square will be 1. GIF of 2.1 is a 2. This will be a 0 also. So correct. So 1.11 also, it will be 0 only. So there will be so many such values. Okay. So there will be infinitely many values of X for which F of X will be 0. Okay. Such that F of X equal to 0. So it is definitely a many one function, right? So option B is correct. Option A partially is correct. Now, is it an into function? It is not going to be an into function because all the expressions involved over here are integers. So this answer will always be an integer. So range will always be integer. Okay. And because of that, many of the real values will not appear in the range, and hence it is an into function. So A and B both are correct actually. And since you have to choose only one of the options, you would go for option number D. So D is absolutely right. Well done. Can we move on to the next one? Next. Poll starts now. Set of all values of P for which this function is bijective. Set of all values of P for which this function is bijective. R to R, we can consider. One minute gone. Okay, last 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. Good response. I could see one of the options, which is option number B, getting most number of votes. 85% of you say option B. Now, this function, of course, would be a continuous function because it is made up of a polynomial and a trig function. Both of them are continuous. So if your inputs are from R to R, your output will also be from output will also be taking care of all the real numbers. So it has to be an onto function, undoubtedly. Now, for it to be a bijective function, it has to be 1-1. So how do we ensure it's a 1-1 function? 1-1 functions are monotonic in nature. So if you see, the derivative of the function should either be greater than or equal to 0 or less than or equal to 0. Cannot be both. Okay. So if you want it to be completely greater than 0, that means P plus cos x should be greater than or equal to 0. In such cases, now remember, this is for all x. So in such cases, your P should be a quantity. P should be a quantity greater than equal to 1. Can I say that? Okay, because if cos x becomes negative 1, P should be such that it is able to make that positive still. So it should be greater than 1, right? Or means union. Your P plus cos x should be less than equal to 0. In this case, if your cos x becomes a plus 1, P should be such that it brings everything to the negative side. So P could be lesser than minus 1. So the union of these two. So either P should be from minus infinity to minus 1, or it should be from 1 to infinity. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, so option number B is right. Next. If a function is defined from R to S as sin x minus root 3 cos x plus 1, and this is onto, then suggest which of the option could be your interval S. Poll starts now. One minute gone, half a minute more I can give you. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. Most of you have said option number A. Okay. Let's discuss this out. See, as you can already see here, we can convert this to a harmonic form. So for harmonic form, you multiply and divide with the two. Okay. Something like this. And this is clearly the formula of sine x minus pi by 3. Okay. Now, for it to be an onto function, S should be the range of the function. So this should be the range of the given function. And range of this function is going to be, max value is going to be 3. Minimum value is going to be minus 1. So minus 1 to 3 will be your answer for the S value. So option number A is correct. Is it fine? Any questions here? Good. Next one. Oh, I think I have my mistake taken some questions. Can it be B and C as well? Okay, let me just check. Okay, now see here, yeah, well, that's a very good question that you asked. It could be B and C also, but normally what happens is we always should mark the most exhaustive options. Okay, you should always go for the most exhaustive option. Even though you think multiple options could be correct in those situations, which might happen because of the question setting glitch, but you should always choose the option which is the most exhaustive. If B and C, F won't be a function. Once again. F won't be a function. Why? Okay, there could be some real values for which you don't get. Yeah. There could be some values for which. Yes, yes, yes. So it may happen that it could not be a function. Correct. Okay, anyways, I'll put the poll on. I'll put the poll on for this. Just give me a second. Relaunch. Yeah, find the domain of this function. Simple question. Everybody should get this. Or by coincidence, maybe Prakul, some of the questions may seem familiar, but not all the questions. There is some person who is constantly marking a wrong option. If that is a sadistic pleasure, please let me tell you, it doesn't affect me. But if it is a conceptual error that you are making, then it's time to learn from that mistake. Okay. Okay, let me stop the poll. I think most of you have already voted. Anybody wants to vote can vote in the next 5 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, as you can see, option number A has got almost 89% votes, but some person has marked B and D as well. Okay, let's check. So this is a pretty simple question for the domain of the function sine inverse. Okay, or let's write it like this. Under root of this should be between minus 1 to 1. But you know that under root quantity is always a positive quantity. So this boils down to this. Okay, which means x minus 1 should lie between 0 to 1. That means x should lie between 1 to 2. Option number A is correct. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Can I go to the next one? There are some faulty questions, I think. My mistake. Just give me a second. Ah. Yeah, let's take this one. Find the domain of this function, cos inverse log of x square plus 5x plus 8 to the base of 2. Relaunch. Last 20 seconds. What Fakul, you went and told that the question that was given was again J level question. Sometimes you find the question is too easy, paper is too easy. Sometimes you say question paper is too hard. Anupama ma'am was telling that. You went and tell it was JEE level question, sir had asked. So what you are oscillating, huh? Okay, we'll solve the poll now. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, most of you have got with option number B. See, paper will be set as per the requirement of the boarding paper. Okay, you should not be judging the paper. It is easy, difficult. If it is easy, score. Isn't it? If it is easy, get 80 on 80. Who is stopping you? Okay. Please do not pass on expert comments on board level papers that, okay, this is easy paper. If it is difficult, everybody will struggle. But normally papers are not made difficult in the board exam. Okay. They are meant for, being solved by 99% of the people. Okay. So log of x square plus 5x plus 8, this should be between minus 1 to 1. That means 2 to the power minus 1. You can write it like this. Okay. That means half. Okay. Now this basically gives you two inequalities, this and this. Okay. But if you see x square plus 5x plus 8, if you write it, it'll be x plus 5 by 2 the whole square. And I think it'll give you 25 by 4. And to make it an 8, I need a 7 by 4. Okay. Now this is anyways greater than half. Okay. This is anyways greater than half. So this will be true for all real numbers. 7 by 4 is more than half, isn't it? So 7 by 4 is of slightly less than 2 maybe. Okay. So you have to take care of the the restriction that it should be less than 2. That means x square plus 5x plus 6 should be less than or equal to 0, which means this should be less than or equal to 0. In short, your x should be between minus 3 to minus 2, close interval, which is option number B clearly. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? So normally we take the overlapping situation for these two situations. So whatever you get from here and whatever you get from here, we take the overlapping of the two because it's a case of a simultaneous solving of those two inequalities. Next. Okay, let's take this one. Poll is on. Easy question. Cos of something is half, and that something is 2 tan inverse x, find the value of x. It's less than a minute question. I will not give you more than a minute. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have gone with option number B, almost 83% of the class. That's absolutely right. So here 2 tan inverse x will be actually pi by 3. That means tan inverse x is pi by 6. That means x is tan pi by 6, which is 1 by root 3. Option number B is right. Okay. Some easy questions also you can get. Don't worry. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Oh, all right. Let's take this question. Choose the incorrect statement. choose the incorrect statement. Cost range wasn't given. What do you mean by that? Cost range was not given. Let me go back. Give me a second. Okay, after this question, we'll go back. Okay, last 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. Most of you have again gone with option C. C is the right option because C. This is definitely a scalar matrix of order one. So this is a correct statement. So this is true. This is also a scalar matrix of order two, correct? This is also a scalar matrix of order three, but the question says it is a, this is order three is not a scalar matrix. So this is the incorrect statement you have to find out. So this is your right answer. Okay. Now going back to the previous question, I think Siddhant had a small doubt with respect to that. Or you figured out your mistake. You have to act according to the options. If there's a, you know, element of doubt, whether there's multiple answers, then you have to act as per the requirement of the options. Okay. Next one. A is a square matrix such that A square is equal to A. Then I minus A cube plus A is equal to which of the following? Awesome. There are people who are actually answering this well, like in, you know, 10 seconds, 5 seconds, like that. That's a good speed. Oh, this was asked for the test. No wonder why. 36 seconds and almost 12 people have responded. Okay, can we close this in another 15 seconds? Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, end of poll. Option A has got almost 83% votes, and then option number C. See, A square is A, idempotent matrix. I've already told you if A square is A, A cube will also be A, A4 will also be A, and so on and so forth, isn't it? So now this is, in this case, you can apply a binomial expansion because I and A operations are commutative. IA, AI are both commutative. So as per the expansion, this will be minus 3A. Then you will have plus 3A and minus A cube. That will also be A. So this plus A. So this cancels. This cancels, leaving you with an I. Option number A is correct. Is it fine? Any questions? Next. So it's a rapid fire round. Sorry, I was doing, yeah, this question done. This question, A and B are of same order. Then AB transpose minus BA transpose. This is a 20 second question. I want immediate response from everybody. Correct, Anusha. This is from the property itself that we had done. Five, four, correct, Pakul. Three, two, one, go. Okay. 21 of you out of 24 say option number A. That's absolutely right. We had already seen this, that if you have the transpose of this, this follows AB transpose whole transpose minus BA transpose whole transpose. Law of reversal will be applied. So it will be B transpose transpose A transpose. This will be A transpose transpose B transpose. So it's BA transpose minus AB transpose, which is negative of our given matrix. Okay. And hence, let's say if you had this as a matrix X, X transpose became minus X. So it's a skew symmetric matrix. Is it fine? Let's move on to the next question. I think I'm going to two down. Let's do this. So there is a product of three matrices. This into A into this is I. Then A is which of the following? Pole is on. One minute gone. I can give you one more minute. Five, four, three, two, One. Go. Okay, so this is one such question where I have not got enough responses. Only 16 of you have voted, and most of you say option number A. See, in this question, most of you approach the problem by choosing your A to be some A, B, C, D. Okay. Raghav, carry on. Okay. But let's say I write it as B, A, C is equal to D. And I want to know what is my A. So to remove this B, I have to pre-facto multiply both sides with B inverse. So this will become an I. Okay. And to remove this C, I have to multiply with C inverse on both the sides. Correct. So this will become an I now. So A will be nothing but B inverse D C inverse. Now finding inverse of a matrix is very, very easy, especially when the matrix is a 2x2. So B was this 2, 1, 3, 2. Okay. So what is the inverse of this matrix? First of all, 1 by determinant will be 1 only. Adjoint will be just switch the position of the leading diagonal and change the sign. Okay. So this will be your B inverse. Similarly, what will be C inverse? C inverse, the determinant is minus 1 because 9 minus 10 is minus 1. Again, switch the position and reverse the sign of these elements, right? So the answer to your question would be 2 minus 1 minus 3, 2 multiplied with 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay. Anyways, you will realize that this is an identity matrix. This is an identity matrix, correct? So this will be as good as this is not into existence at all. Okay. Multiplied with C inverse. C inverse is nothing but 3, 2, 5, 3. Okay. So it's 6 minus 5, 1. 4 minus 3, 1. Minus 9 plus 10, 1. Minus 6 plus 6, 0. Option number A is correct. Is it fine? Now, it all depends upon how convenient you are with whatever way you are taking. I mean, I'm not imposing this, but this could be one of the methodologies you can adopt to solve the question. Can I go to the next one now? Any questions here, anybody? All right, next one. Okay, let's take this question. Poll is on. 2 minutes gone. I can give 30 more seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Yes, right, Aditya. So most of you have said option number A, but the number of people who have responded is quite less. Only 15 people have responded. Okay, let's check this. So when you do A square, let's see what do we get. Because as you can see, all the expressions here are actually powers of 2 only. A square, A4, A6, etc. So let's see what do we get when you write A square. Okay. So this multiplied with this, I'll give you a 1. This multiplies with this, that will give you a 0. This with this will again give you a 0. This with this will again give you a 0. This with this will give you a 1. This with this will give you a 0. This will give you a 0 again. This with this will give you 0. Sorry, this with this will give you a 0. B minus B, 0 again. This with this will give you a 1. Oh, so you get an I. That means a to the power 4 is also I, a to the power 6 also is I, a to the power 8 also is I, and so on and so forth, isn't it? So if you see here, this is I, 2I, 4I. So all together, this sum should be equal to 7I. And whichever option says 7I directly or indirectly will be your answer, which is clearly option number A. Can't be B, can't be C, can't be D. Okay, A is the right option. Is it fine? Any questions here? Can I move on to the next one? Next one. A is this, is the sum of symmetric matrix B and skew symmetric matrix C. What is B in this case? Again, within 30 seconds, I need the answer. See, some of you are answering within 15, 20 seconds also. Means it is easy. It is worth doing in 15, 20 seconds. Correct. Yeah, this option has been very, you can say, designed in a very foolish way, I would say. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have said option A, absolutely right. So the only one option which is actually a symmetric matrix is A. Right? These are all, they are not symmetric matrices. Fine. But if you want to solve this question in a faster way, I've already told you the trick. Just copy the leading diagonal as it is, 6 to 1. Then add these two, divide by 2 and distribute it like this. So take a mean and put it in the two positions whose mean you have taken. Okay. Similarly, 9 plus 5, 14, mean is 7, 7. Okay. Then 7 and 3, mean is 5, 5. So option number A is correct. In case of skew symmetric, what do you do? Let's say the question was, what is the skew symmetric matrix? Let's say C. Then what will you do? Copy 0, 0, 0 in the leading diagonal. I'm just telling you how to save time. Okay, please take this into your consideration. Then subtract these two. Okay, and divide it by 2. Correct? So this will be 2. So 8 minus 4. Now, which one to be taken as 8? It is always the one in the row position. This to be taken minus this. So you do Aij minus Aji by 2. And this is to be written in this position. Here it will come negative of it. Please understand. Okay. Similarly, 5 minus 9 by 2, which is minus 2. And there will be a negative of this coming in this position. Getting my point? Similarly, 3 minus 7 by 2, that will come here. And negative of this will come over here. Is this fine? How to get the skew symmetric matrix also fast? Okay, great. Next. If A is this, 10B is this, and B is the inverse of A, find alpha. Simple question, should not take more than a minute. Okay, 5, 4, 3. 2, 1. Cool. Okay, end of poll. Only 11 people got this right. I mean, they are saying the same option. And I'm assuming that since most of you have replied to that, it is right. So B is the inverse of A. So can I say if I do A and times 10B, that should give you 10I because it is as good as this. Correct. This is I. So you multiply it and equate it to 10i. 10i is this. Okay. But see, don't have to, you know, worry about all the elements. See, where is alpha involved? So alpha will be involved if I multiply the first row with the last column and I could equate it to zero. So 2 minus alpha plus 3 is 0. Alpha is 5. Problem is solved. Option number A is correct. Okay. Don't try to equate everything. Unnecessarily, you just have one variable to figure it out. Okay. And most of you would be like sitting and, you know, getting 4 plus 5 plus 1, 10. So how does it matter? 10 equal to 10. Fine. Does it help you to get alpha? No. So why unnecessarily, you know, find all those things? See which element in which multiplication alpha will be involved. So you can either take, you know, first row and the last column and compare it with this fellow. That will basically feature in alpha. And if it feature in alpha, you can find the value. Next. Okay, let's take this one. B is a non-singular matrix, A is a square matrix, then determinant of BA, B inverse. Simple. Touch and go. Should we start the countdown? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. End of poll. Most of you have said option C, which is definitely right in this case. See, basically it works on two important things. Determinant AB is determinant A, determinant B, provided both A and B are square matrices. And determinant of A inverse is determinant A whole inverse. Okay. So if you apply this, so determinant of, why am I writing DET? I could have written this symbol. So this could be determinant of B inverse, determinant of A, determinant of B. And this is 1 by determinant of B, which basically cancels off with this, giving you determinant A as the answer, which is option number C. Next question. Which of the following is the inverse of this given matrix? Max, I can give you 1.5 minutes for this. So good practice of finding inverse also. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so in such kind of questions, go for, the scamming part here. Most of you have said option number C. See, first of all, if you check, multiply the first row with the first column over here. You'll get a 3 - 8 + 6. That is 1. Will this give you the same? Check. 3 + 12 + 10. This doesn't give you that. So everywhere where there is this thing involved, that will be rejected. So B and D are gone for a toss. Okay. But now if you see option A and C both have the first thing common, correct? The last also common. So just go for this multiplication. Okay. With this one. So this row with this column, is it giving us a zero? Let's check. So 9 - 12 + 14. This is not giving us a zero. So this cannot be my option. Is it fine? So only option C is correct. Don't sit and evaluate it completely. Even if you want to, please don't do that. How did you eliminate V and D? So this multiplied with this did not give me a zero. Did not give me a one. I'm sorry. Did not give me a one. Got it, Hariharan. Why should it? Because they're inverses of each other. So their product should give you a 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1. AB is equal to I know. So let's say I take this as an A. And this is my B. Okay, this should give me I. Okay. By the way, just to revise this fact, everybody knows how to find inverse by using the shortcut method, which I discussed with you. I'll repeat it once again, just for the benefit of everybody and revising the theory. So the approach was, we used to copy the first row and the second row, and then copy the first column and second column. Okay. Score this off. Okay. So crisscross. Okay. So 1 - 0, write it like this. Okay. Then -2 + 4 is going to be 2. Write it in this position. Similarly, -2, write it in this position. Then again, 2, write it in this position. 5, write it in this position. -4, write it here. 2 + 1 = 3, write it in this position. And 4 + 3 = 7, write it in this position. And 3 - 8, which is -5, write it in this position. So this becomes your adjoint. Okay. So anything proportional to this, that will be your answer. But by the way, this thing is exactly matching with this. So don't even go for finding the determinant, because your inverse will be this into some proportionality constant, which is your 1 by determinant. Okay, is this fine? So this is your adjoint of A. So A inverse is 1 by determinant adjoint of A. Everybody knows that. I think determinant will come out to be 1 in this case. Can we go to the next question now? Next. Poll is on. If A is a non-singular matrix of order 3 and determinant of the adjoint is determinant to the power n, find the value of n. I can give you maximum 15 more seconds. Super easy question. Five, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. 19 of you have said option number A, which is definitely right. So please make a note of this. Again, a quick revision of this part. Determinant of adjoint of A is determinant A to the power of n minus 1, n being the order of that given square matrix. If you have determinant of adjoint of A, it becomes determinant A to the power n minus 1 square. And this can be extended. That means if you have adjoint m number of times, okay, so there are m number of adjoints, then the answer becomes determinant A to the power of n minus 1. Only n minus 1 has to be raised to a power of m. Okay, this is the most generic formula. So it can be applied here also. It can be applied here also. So this is the most generic formula. Can I go to the next question? Which one of the following statement is true? Easy. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Should this take the best call? take the best option possible. Okay. So I can see 20. People are still polling. Okay. 23 of you have voted. Out of his 17 have gone for option C. See, first of all, a non-singular matrix doesn't have a unique inverse. A non-singular matrix will always, the inverse is always unique. So this is a false statement. Determinant of a non-singular matrix is zero. No, it is for a singular matrix, it is zero. So wrong statement. If A transpose is equal to A, then A is a symmetric matrix, and symmetric matrix are supposed to be square matrices. Okay, so this is to a certain extent correct. And the last one, you already know that determinant of A into adjoint of A would be nothing but determinant of A into determinant of adjoint of A. And that is nothing but determinant A into determinant A to the power N minus 1. So that will give you determinant A to the power N actually, not this. So option C is the best possible option. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns, do let me know. C is not correct. Why? If A transpose is A, so let's say M by N transpose, if you say they are equal, that means M and N should be equal. So it becomes square matrix. Now, what is the issue in that? Then, see, I'm not saying if A is a square matrix, then A transpose is equal to A. So it's a unidirectional logic. It's an implication. If this is true, then A is a square matrix. Is it correct or not? Whether that square matrix is symmetric, skew symmetric, how does it matter to us? Why are we reading the converse of it? Read this mathematical statement. If P, then Q. Why are you reading if Q, then P? Next. Time to take some determinant problems also. Yeah. If P lambda to the power 4 plus Q lambda to the power 3 da, 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 is this, find the value of T. Simple question. Poll is on. I should get this answer within 35, 40 seconds, not more than that. Oh, 30 seconds gone. Only one answer I got. So relation functions, inverse trig, matrices, determinants, continuity, differentiability, I mean, including differentiation and application of derivatives and linear programming problems. That is all you have for CBSE people. Anything that I have missed out? Yeah, application of derivatives are counted. Okay. Yes. Should I start the countdown? Very few people have answered. 5, 4, okay, Ruchita, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. Now, why less people responded to this is the reason why, is the reason because many of you went for actual evaluation of the determinant. You could just put lambda as 0 on both the sides. That will leave you with a T. So those who got it fast, it is because you had put lambda as 0 in this equation. So 0, minus 1, 3, 1, 2, minus 4, minus 3, 4, 0. You just had to evaluate this determinant. That is going to be your answer. So it will be 1, 0, and minus 12, and plus 3, 4 plus 6, 10. So it's going to be 30 minus 12, which is 18. Option number B is correct. Is it fine? Any questions here? Next. I think I have missed some good questions. We'll take them up first. Yeah, we'll take this one. Okay, A inverse is given to you. Which of the following option is correct? Do you think it's a multiple option? I don't think so. It should be a multiple option. But if it is, do let me know. Okay. Some of you are giving me multiple options. Okay, fine. If you feel it's a multiple option, then give me a response on the chat box. Okay. 20 more seconds, I'll close the poll. 5, 4, 3. Okay, Aryan, Rashmika. 3, 2, 1. Go. Okay, great. So, end of poll. B is the most, you know, chosen response. Let's check whether B was correct or there's a multiple option correct. So first of all, what is determinant of A inverse? This you can expand with respect to the last column. So -2, -2, +1, which is -2, +1, which is -1. So determinant of A inverse is 2, which means determinant of A is half. Okay. And determinant of A and A transpose both are same. So this cannot be correct. This cannot be correct. Fine. Now, determinant of adjoint of A would be determinant A to the power of N minus 1, which is 1 by 4. This cannot be correct. Right? So that leaves you with option number B. But is B also correct? Let's verify it. So A inverse is 1 by determinant A into adjoint of A. Okay, so you just have to multiply determinant A to this given matrix and that will give you the adjoint of A. So half multiplied to this matrix, definitely gives you this. Okay, so this is, okay, option number B is correct. But really surprised to see most of you got it wrong. Not most of you means the response was not that great on this. Yeah, in fact, most of you, no, not most of you, I would say 7 of you got it wrong out of 16. Next. Something wrong with my... Something is wrong with my pen. Okay, so if this determinant is equal to this expression, find C value. Find the value of C. Poll is on. Oh, 1 minute gone and 1% only responded. Janta is slow in this question. See, it doesn't mean that it's a school level question. You'll use your school level concepts only to solve it. This is an objective paper. Nobody is going to question you in what approach you took. So you can use whatever, you know, J concepts or engineering entrance exam concepts you have learned to solve this question. Nobody is going to ask you, how did you solve it? Okay, I'll be stopping this in another 30 seconds because response is very less. Almost only 8 of you have responded. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so just 16 of you have voted, out of which 9 say option number D. See, let's say this is some function of x. Can I say c value will be f dash 0? Can I say that? That means if you differentiate this determinant and put x as 0, that will be your c value. Okay, so differentiation happens. Differentiation happens one row at a time. Okay. Slip off my pen. Yeah. So differentiate the first row first. So you'll get 1, 5, 0. And in other, you have to put 0. So minus 1, minus 1, 8, 0, 0, 0. So this anyways goes for a toss. Now, first row put a 0, minus 1, 0, 7. Differentiate the second row and put a 0. So 2x will be 0. This will be 1. This will be 0. And this will be 0, 0, 0. Going for a toss. Then third row, differentiate, you'll get 2, 3, 0, and 0, 0 here will give you minus 1, 0, 7, minus 1, minus 1, 8. So all you need to do is evaluate this determinant and your answer will be there. Let's choose our last row to evaluate it. So plus, minus, plus, so 2, this will be 7, and minus 3, so this will be minus 8 plus 7, 1. Have I missed out anything? Do let me know. Oh, minus 1. Sorry. Yeah. So 14 plus 3, 17 is the answer. Option number D is correct. How you decided? See, this is the f of x expression, right? Okay. So if I want to just find out C, let's say if I differentiate it once, I'll be left with 3ax squared, 2bx plus c. And I want these two to vanish. So I'll put x as 0. That's how we get c. Isn't it? Had I wanted only d, I would have put x as 0. Something like that. So you have to see. You have to see which approach is giving you the faster result. Rather than manually expanding it. Of course, manually expanding will also give you the answer. But if you are, you know, let's say having a time crunch, why to do all these things? Correct? No, but why? That means you have not practiced enough determinant questions where differentiation is involved. So this kind of concepts are very well known to get these coefficients. Derivative, putting some special values, all those stuff. 3 means I didn't get you. What is this 3? What is that 3, Prakul? What are the 3 determinants? Ayo! You didn't attend the determinants class on differentiation of determinants. Go do one thing. Now a task for you. Go and watch that video. Oh, if you're absent for a class, then the teacher can't help it. Okay, so this is a question which says the value of lambda says that the given system of equation has no solution. Poll is on. Done. Only four people have responded. 1 minute gone. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Okay, 2 minutes gone. Only 12 people voted, out of which 7 say option number D. So solving the equation part is there, no, for your syllabus, CBSE. I think for ISC it is not there, but CBSE is it there, right? Yeah, it's there. Yeah. So the first and the foremost thing that you would be writing is that this determinant should be 0. Okay. Now, determinant equal to 0 could also lead to infinitely many solutions, but this is a necessary condition. Okay, so if you just evaluate it, you get -2 lambda plus 1 and 4 times 1 plus 2, which is 3, which is 0. So -4 lambda plus 2 plus lambda plus 1 plus 12 is equal to 0. So you end up getting 3 lambda is equal to 15. So lambda is 5. Lambda is 5, but that is not in the option. Okay, let me check if I missed out anything. So -1 lambda plus 1, and this is, oh, this is -4. Hey, last type of mistake that anybody should do. Okay, so this is 3 lambda is equal to -9 then. Sorry about that. So lambda is going to be -3. So I was lucky that there was no 5 option sitting there, else I would have gone. So this is the necessary condition. So hence, okay. So this may also give you infinitely many solutions, but the necessary condition has to be satisfied, which is coming from -3. Next. So last question on determinants, then we'll move on to AOD and continuity and differentiability. Yeah. The value of this determinant is which of the following? Poll is on. Simple, should be within like 10 second question. People who could take my guess 10 seconds have already started giving the answer. Okay, last 15 seconds I can give you. So those who want to poll, please do so. Five, four, three, two, one, go. So 18 of you only responded, out of which 14 say option number D. D is absolutely right. It's 0 actually, because if you add R1 as R1 plus R3, you'll end up getting 2x, 2y, 2z. Okay. And just take a 2 common from the first row. If you take a 2 common from the first row, you'll end up getting the first and the second row identical. and that will make the determinant collapse. Option number D is correct. Or put X, yeah, correct. Put X equal to Y equal to Z, because none of the options here will basically cater to the fact, let's say each of them are one, one each. So only option D will cater to the requirement. Maybe we can take one of these properties. Seems to be good. Who knows? Ayo, not this one. Somehow my system is reacting very slow today. See, I'm pressing the down button. It is not moving only. Now I got the point. Maybe the Bluetooth of my keyboard is far off. Technical issues. One second. Poll is on.
Where is my Bluetooth?
So my Bluetooth has gone very far off. Yes, easy question, 5 second question, just to make you revise the concept. It is like, no, I'm not trying to test you here. So A is a square matrix of order 4, I is a identity, I is a unit matrix, then which of the following is true? Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, 100% vote has gone to option number B. So we already know this property that determinant of KA is K to the power N determinant of A, N being the order of the matrix. So this cannot be your answer. This can be your answer. And this is minus 1 to the power 1. So this is actually an order 4. So minus 1 to the power N means minus 1 to the power 4. This cannot be your option. And there's no such property like this. Determinant A plus I is determinant A plus I. So option number B is only correct. See, now my keyboard is working. I think we can go for, there was one property based question. Yeah, this. A and B are invertible matrices. Invertible square matrices of the same order. Which of the following is not correct? That means wrong option you have to pick up. This also is very simple. Five, four, three. Aditya, that is conjugate. AB conjugate is A conjugate, B conjugate. Rest all obey law of reversal, whether it is a transpose of conjugate, whether it is inverse, whether it is transpose, whether it's adjoint. Okay. All right. So I'll be stopping the poll now. Most of you have got it right. Option C is the wrong statement and hence the right option. So law of reversal is valid for adjoint also. Okay. And adjoint A transpose and adjoint of A whole transpose will give you the same. So that means this is also a true statement, but this should be actually N minus one, not 2N minus one. Okay. So this is a wrong statement. And here see, adjoint of B is what? Adjoint of B is determinant B into B inverse. Correct? Yes or no? So when you put adjoint B in place of B, what do you get? Determinant of adjoint B into adjoint B inverse. Oh. Adjoint of B inverse. Okay. Now, adjoint of B is determinant B to the power of N minus 1. Okay. What about adjoint B inverse? How do you find that out? So adjoint of B is determinant B into B inverse. So adjoint of B whole inverse is going to be this, correct? So you are going to put determinant B to the power of minus one times B, which is determinant B to the power N minus two into B. However, I had given you a direct formula also for this when I was, you know, giving you the property. So this is also a true statement. Now, don't be happy that you figured out C if you were not aware of either of B, C or D, because you never know, a question could have been framed on those as well. So let's take it as a learning, whichever part we were not aware of. How is first option A true? Law of reversal is applicable to adjoint of this thing. So, okay, see. Are you convinced that AB inverse is B inverse A inverse? Are you aware of this property at least? Okay. Now, inverse of a matrix is 1 by determinant AB into adjoint of AB. Similarly, this will be 1 by determinant of B adjoint of B, 1 by determinant A adjoint of A. And if A and B are square matrices, then this term will be determinant A into determinant B. And since they're invertible, they're non-zero, they can be cancelled off. And that's how you get adjoint AB is adjoint of B into adjoint of A. Law of reversal holds valid. Okay. All right. Now we'll go to continuity and differentiability. Enough of matrices and determinants. Let's go to the poll is on. Okay, almost 1 minute gone. Just 7 of you. Chalo, I'll give 1 more minute. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. All right, end of poll. Most of you have gone with option number C. It is continuous for all X, but not differentiable at zero. Okay, let's check it out. So let us redefine this function first of all. So when X is negative, this will be x e to the power. When x is negative, this just becomes a zero. So it is just an x. Okay. When x is equal to zero, they have already given it is zero. And when x is positive, it will be x e to the power negative 2 by x. Okay. Now, is it continuous? Let us check it out at see. Left hand limit at zero and right hand limit at zero, both are equal to zero each. Am I right? Why? Because left hand limit, anyways, you put zero in this. Okay. Right hand limit, if you see this quantity as x tends to zero plus, this is a negative infinity quantity. So this is anyways tending to zero. Okay. And X is also tending to zero. So overall, this entire expression will be tending to zero. So continuous everywhere, that is fine. Okay. So option number A and D are ruled out. Correct. Now let us check the differentiability issue. So left hand derivative is 1, undoubtedly. Okay. What is the right hand derivative? So for right hand derivative, I will follow the first principles here because I feel more convenient with that. So it will be 0 plus h minus f of 0 by h. So f of 0 plus h will be h e to the power minus 2 by h minus 0 by h. Limit h tending to 0 plus. This h and this h goes. And again, as I told you, when h tends to 0 plus, this is minus infinity. So e to the power, a very large negative number, will be zero. So left hand derivative is 1, but right hand derivative is 0. So it is not differentiable at zero. So it is continuous for all x, but not differentiable at zero. Very good. Answer C is the option. C is the right option. Is it fine? Any questions here? Anybody? Next. ISC people, I just spoke to the resource people. They are telling that the best of the two sections will be taken into account. So I think somebody was asking me whether I can attempt, let's say, one of the sections properly and take a guesswork in the other section. You can do that. You can do that. Okay. I'll give you 20 more seconds. Please wrap this up in the 20 more seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. D is the most chosen response. Let's see. You can see here that the question checker basically is interested in knowing in the neighborhood of x equal to 1 point. Okay. So let's redefine this function. When x is less than 1, when x is equal to 1, and when x is greater than 1. Less than 1, you know, GIF is going to become a 0. I'm just talking in the neighborhood of 1. Okay, don't say, sir, less than 0 can be minus 100 also, right? So I'm just interested in neighborhood of 1. Don't go and redefine it as minus 100 and minus 5 lakh. Not required. In the neighborhood of 1, that means slightly left and right of 1, I'm interested in. Okay. So when x is slightly less than 1, this is going to be minus 1 by x minus 1. And when x is slightly more than 1, this is going to be 0. Am I right? Is it continuous at x equal to 0? If you see, the left-hand limit is 1. Right-hand limit is 0. Value of the function is 0. So it is discontinuous at x equal to 0. X equal to 1. So if it is discontinuous at x equal to 1, there is no point doing any further check because it is going to be non-differentiable also because it is discontinuous. Option number D was correct. Everybody should have got this right. Is it fine? Any question, any concerns here? So only in the neighborhood of x equal to 1, you will make this analysis. Don't start defining it from very far off intervals. Is this fine? Let's go on to the next one. Simple question. But conceptual question, if you're making mistake here, means conceptually something is flawed. Okay, people have answered this already. X is f of t. So there's a curve which is parametrically defined. You have to find d2y by dx squared. Okay, I'll stop this in another 15 seconds. Oh, there are people who are opting for option A also. Ramakrishna. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, thankfully, most of you have gone for the right option, which is option number B in this case. So please understand, double derivative doesn't mean double derivative of y with respect to t by double. See, get these wrong notions out of your mind. It's high time you start, you know, realizing that this doesn't work like this. There is no such. Okay. So please do not do this. So double derivative means what? Double derivative means you have to first differentiate, first find dy by dx, and from there you have to differentiate it once more again with respect to x. Okay. So dy by dx, yes, this can be said, no doubt about it. This is fine. This is absolutely correct. So dy by dx will be g dash t by f dash t. Okay. Now you have to find the double derivative, means you have to differentiate this with respect to x. Okay. So as per our chain rule, you first differentiate this with respect to t, because it's a function of t, into dt by dx. Into dt by dx means you're actually doing this. Derivative of this divided by dx by dt. So derivative of this with respect to t will follow quotient rule. So it is f dash g double dash minus g dash f double dash by f dash square. But dx by dt is also f dash. So there will be one more f dash. Okay, so it will become f dash. Let me not write. Okay, that's fine. Since I've written one. By f dash t whole cube. Okay, so option number C is correct. Option number B is correct. Is it fine? Any questions? Next. If a function is defined like this, the points at which f of x is continuous. Number of points at which f of x is continuous. Poll is on. This I had actually done in the theory session also. Yes, modification on Dirichlet function. Okay, should we stop the poll now? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, slightly disappointed to see the result. Most of you have gone with C. Answer is actually, it is discontinuous. It is continuous only at one point. That is half. So limit x tending to half minus. Okay. Now, half minus, whether the number is rational or irrational over here, okay, it doesn't matter whether you use x or 1 minus x. Okay. Both of them will give you half of each. Same will be limit of x tending to half plus. Whether you use 1 minus or x, both will be half of each. And at half, it is definitely half. So half is the only one point where it is continuous. So Janta was wrong in this. Only 4 people got it right out of 13 who voted. It is not a Dirichlet function. It is similar to that. Dirichlet function is where you are hopping between 2 different values, which cannot be made the same. For example, this is 5, this is 7, which cannot be made the same. Here, the value for which x and 1 minus x will become same, at that value, the function will become continuous only. That's the only value where the function will be continuous. So it will be discontinuous everywhere other than the value for which both of them will give you the same answer. So all you need to do is figure out that value, and which was half in this case. So it is continuous only at that point, half. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Bakul, what is happening? Chalo, it's okay that you do all your mistakes now only. So that stakes are, and the stakes are low. Yeah, derivative of this with respect to cos inverse. Very simple question. Should not take you more than 5 seconds to answer this. I mean, ideally in the school and all, they don't worry about the interval actually. Good. People have pounced upon the option. There is some person who is invariably putting B as the answer. I don't know why. Whether the person wants to just remove that poll from his view. So, social experiment. Yeah, maybe he's trying to experiment that if I do all B, 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 what is my chances that I will, you know, pass in this? Invariably, you'll fail actually if you do that. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Yes, option that is correct is A. Because this is 2 cos inverse x, if you are aware of the formula. So 2 cos inverse x derivative with respect to cos inverse x is going to be 2 only. Okay. So option number, okay. So let's take a break right now because we have solved almost 30 questions continuously. 10 minutes break would be fine. Okay, let's meet in 10 minutes time. I think I have forgotten to put the recording on. Yes, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. So end of poll, most of you have gone with B and C combined, I would say, because 8 of you have said B and C. Okay. But maximum, polls have gone to A. Okay. So let's check what is the result for this. See, you want to know where the function is decreasing, right? So derivative should be less than equal to 0. Okay. So it will be secant square x minus 4. Okay. Now you want this to be negative. That means secant square x should be less than 4. Okay. By the way, that means secant x should be less than 2, correct? But this guy is always more than 1, correct? So it has to be between 1 and 2. Am I right? Or between minus 2 to minus 1, correct? Is it fine? So this basically means that your cosec should be between half to 1. Okay, half to 1, half to 1, if you see, half to 1 comes from 0 to pi by 3. Okay, and this means cosec should be between minus 1 to minus half. Am I right? Have I missed out anything? Do let me know. Okay. Achha, minus 1 to half is this interval also. Forgot about that, because 1 to half, it will be from this interval. Okay. Now this will go into 2 pi by 3 to pi interval. So that I'm not interested in, because in none of my intervals I have actually crossed pi. Okay. So the option which is correct from the provided option is where your x has to be between minus pi by 3 to pi by 3, exclusive of both of them. So option number A is going to be right. Is it fine? Any questions here? Any concerns here? Do let me know. Okay. So good. Next one. Simple question. Poll is on. F of x is x by sine x. G of x is x by tan x. X is somewhere between 0 to 1, exclusive of 0. Then which of the following option is correct? Very simple question. Okay, 5 of you have responded. Almost 1.5 minutes gone. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Cool. Okay. Only 12 of you responded. 6 of you say A and B, and 6 of you say C. Okay, so it's very obvious here that, you know, we have been always talking about these kind of functions. X by sine x. See, when you're very close, when you're positive, x is higher than sine x. Okay, when they're very close to zero, they can be approximated to be equal to each other almost. But when as x grows, this will be growing at a faster rate. Okay, so this overall function will be an increasing function. Fine. See, and if you, I mean, normally if you predict the graph of it, it will be going like this. It will be going up like this. Okay. And tan x graph will be coming down. X by tan x graph will be coming down like this. So this will be the graph of x by sin x, and this will be the graph of x by tan x. So this is a decreasing function. This will be a decreasing function because this will increase at a much faster rate as compared to this. Okay. So either they say f of x is increasing somewhere, or they say g of x is decreasing somewhere. But the problem is in the option one, they say both are increasing. That is not correct. Both are decreasing. That is not correct. Yes, this says f of x is increasing. They should ideally have said g of x is decreasing, but it says increasing. So this is also wrong. So option C is the only right option. Okay. If you try to do it by your derivative concept, does it give you a definitive result or something? Section C, section B part, we'll be doing it tomorrow towards the end. Okay, not today. We don't have much time to do all those part. Yes, is there any person who tried to solve this by using the actual approach of finding the derivative in this interval? Did it give you any kind of a definitive result? Anybody who did this? Exactly. You will get stuck if you try to do it by that method. It will not help you out. So basically you have to rely on your bit of your understanding about the relationship between sin x, x and a tan x. Yeah. Next. On which of the following intervals is the function f defined by this is strictly decreasing? Again, a simple question. Poll is on. You have to look at the options and then take a judgment. Okay. So don't take a judgment just by looking at the function. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, okay, Prakul, one. Yeah, please vote, everybody. Okay. So I have got almost all the options been touched upon, but D has got most number of votes. See, the derivative of this function would be 100 x to the power 99 plus cos x. Okay. Now it can't be 0 to 1 because 0 to 1, everything will be positive. So it cannot be strictly decreasing in that interval because you have to find out strictly decreasing. Okay. What about pi by 2 to pi? See, pi by 2 to pi, this guy will be negative. That is fine. But this guy will be super high in value because pi by 2 itself is 1.57. So you're talking about some value between 1.57 to 3.4-ish. 3.14-ish. To the power 99. Oh my God, that will be very, very large value actually. Okay. So it will be much larger than this. So this cannot be your answer. What about 0 to pi by 2? 0 to pi by 2, anyways, this is going to be positive and this is going to be positive. So it cannot be decreasing there also. So this also cannot be your answer. So only possible answer is none of these. I mean, there's no such value interval here for which the function is going to be decreasing. So why people are changing their answer? Why, Prakul, what made you change it to C all of a sudden? Actual interval, that depends on the question. So see, it's a mix of a polynomial and a trig function. It's very difficult to comment on that. So when such question comes, they will probably provide you an interval. Okay. But if you see x to the power 100, okay, let's try to just graph it up. Let's see what happens when we graph it up. What was it? X to the power 100 minus sine x or plus sine x? Yeah, plus sine x. Okay. So, yeah. It is actually decreasing for a very small value of x. I mean, see, it, from here it is increasing only. Okay, but it is falling for a very, very sharp, very, very small interval of x. Very difficult to figure this out. It is falling. I mean, no doubt it is falling, but it is falling for a very, very small interval of x. Okay. Where probably x to the power 100, where probably 100 x to the power 99 is being dominated by cos x, that interval. And it is very close in the neighborhood of minus one, somewhere in the neighborhood of minus one. Minus one radians. Okay, let's move on. Next question. Find the angle of intersection of these two curves. Pole is on. Okay. Most of you have gone. In fact, all of you have gone with one of the options. No wonder. And people have done this many times as well. Okay, good. Should we then close the poll in the next 5 seconds? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Okay. There's still B sayers. B sayers are guest workers. Most of you have gone with C, by the way, which is 90 degree. Okay, let's check. So don't sit and waste time finding the point of intersection. Just find your general expression for dy by dx for both the curves. Okay, so you can use minus dou f by dou x, dou f by dou y for both the curves. This is for C1, let's say. This is your C1 curve. So it's negative of 3x squared minus 3y squared upon dou f by dou y will be minus 6xy. Okay. That actually results into x square minus y square by 2xy. Dy by dx for curve 2 minus dou f by dou x will be 6xy upon dou f by dou y minus 3x square minus 3y square. So it's actually 2xy by x square minus y square with a negative sign. Yes, their product for any x, y where they meet will be definitely a minus one. Okay, so option number C is correct. Is it fine? Any questions? Let's take another one. Find the range of this function. Oh, poll. One and a half minutes gone. Only three people have responded to this question. Okay, I can give one more minute. By the way, option C and D and option, all these options, they will all differ from each other in the brackets. See the use of the brackets. The figures are same. Okay, 5, 4, 3, two, one, go. Okay, most of you have gone with option D. Okay, let's discuss it out. Whether D is correct or not. See, what is the range of the, what is the domain of the function? Domain of the function is more than 2, but less than 4, right? So this is the domain of the function, correct? So basically we are finding the least and the greatest value of the function in this interval, okay? So let us first find out where is the maxima or minima point coming up for this function. By the way, this function will always be a increasing function. Am I right? Will it be increasing function always? What do you say? Okay, let's check. I don't think so. We'll be able to comment on this. So let's do one thing. Let's find out where is the stationary point occurring for this. So 2 by 2 under root x minus 2. Oh, there's a minus sign coming in. Sorry, I didn't realize there's a minus sign. So now we cannot comment. So it's 1 by under root x minus 2, 1 by 2 under root 4 minus x. Okay, anyways, for stationary point, dy by dx should be 0. Okay, for stationary point, whether it's a maxima or minima, let's figure out where it is coming out to be 0. So this means 1 by under root x minus 2 is 1 by 2 under root 4 minus x. So 16 minus 4x is x minus 2. So 18 by 5. Okay, so 3.6, okay, is the point, which is the point of inflection. So now what are we going to do? We are manually going to test at these points. Remember, what did I say when we were talking about global maxima and minima? So in an interval, when you're trying to find out what's the max and the min value, we put the value of the function in the endpoints of the interval, which is your domain interval here, and also at the stationary point. So when you put a 2, you will end up getting a 0 here, and this will give you a root 2. So this gives you a root 2. When you put an 18 by 5, you end up getting 2 under root of 18 by 5 minus 2, which is 8 by 5, plus under root of 4 minus 18 by 5, which is again 2 by 5. Okay. How much does it come out to be? Root 8 is 4 root 2. So 4 root 2 by root 5. So it's 5 root 2 by root 5. So that's actually root 10. Oh, this comes out to be root 10. So it has to be a maxima point actually. Yeah. And 4 will again give us a 4 will again give us a 0, and this is 2 root 2. 2 root 2 is actually root 8. Okay. So out of all these things, this is the maximum point and this is the minimum point. Now, I would not have done all these things because since this is a closed interval, your maximum and minimum value will be achievable at some point. So there is no point choosing A, B, or a C in that case, right? But if I were given different value figures over here, then probably I would have done all these things. But if you take my call, I would have just marked this question in 1 second only. I would not have even bothered to look at A, B, and C. Isn't it? Because your domain is closed, right? Domain is closed. So we are not worried about any point being not, or any value of the function not being achievable. Is it fine? So I solved this question in a complete way, just to give you an idea about how to go about with these kind of questions as well. Let's take another one. f of x is this expression. This is a decreasing function of x in R. Find the set of possible values of a. A is a constant. It's independent of x. Super easy question. Two minutes gone. Only four people have responded. Five. Four. Three. Two. One. Go. Okay, this was actually a very easy question, but many of you did not choose to respond. Most of you have gone by C, which is actually the right option, because if you differentiate this and you want this to be negative, the derivative of this will become this. Okay, so this is just a coefficient of x cube. If you want this to be negative, this should be a parabola which should be opening downwards, because you're saying it is true for all x. So this should be a downward opening parabola. Okay, for downward opening parabola, the coefficient of x square should be negative. That means this should be negative, which means your a should be between minus 1 to 1. Okay, now equal to 1, equal to minus 1, that is also permissible. Okay, because in that case, it will become a negative 3. And for that matter, it is negative only, correct? So equal to 1 is also permissible. Equal to minus 1 is also permissible. So in light of all this thing, option C is the right option. Option C is the right option. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? If this was an advected quadratic, then you know that your discriminant should be negative. Okay, so just to recall, if you want to solve this particular inequality, and let's say this is true for all x belonging to the domain of the function, which is all real number, then a should be negative, number one, and your discriminant should be less than zero. By the way, equal to zero if they want, then this should be less than equal to zero. A plus 3. Okay. Yeah. Then in that case, what will happen? B square minus 4AC. Then you have to check this part. Minus, because B is not there, no. So minus 4AC, that should be negative. That part you have to check. Right? No, Aditya. So it would be a downward opening parabola, but yeah, but zero, it would be shifted up. No. Correct, correct. In that case, it will not be possible. Yes, right. Because let's say even if it is a downward opening parabola, at zero, it would be at three. That means it would be positive for some values of x. Yes, in that case, it will not be possible. Okay. Next one. Remember, the domain is only x greater than zero. So in this interval, is this function increasing, decreasing, both increasing, decreasing? None of these. Simple. Less than a minute question. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so somebody had to mark. So most of you have gone with B. Only one person has said A. Okay, so if you differentiate this, it'll become -1/(1+x²). Derivative of this is -1+x. If x is positive, this will definitely be a negative quantity. So it's a decreasing function. Next. I think this would be the last question for the day. It's actually a very easy question. I mean, 1 minute has gone, but I can see just four of you having responded to this question. It's quite easy, actually. Not zero, one everywhere. Okay. Okay. Chalo, should we end the poll? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. End of poll. Most of you have given option number A. That's actually the right option. See, it's just an eyewash. This whole thing is going to be zero because 0 to π/2, this guy is going to give you a zero. So it's a constant function. So constant function is neither increasing nor decreasing. So both of these options are gone. Global maxima is 1. So only thing you can say it is continuous in 0 to π/2. Okay. All right. We'll stop here. I think most of you would be now exhausted. 3 hours of 3 hours, almost 20 minutes of problem solving. Tomorrow's session, we'll continue with the same exercise. But in tomorrow's session, I will have few questions on section B as well. On vectors in 3D as well. Especially in the last half an hour. Especially for people who are going to be writing their ISC, 12 ISC students. So CBSE people can opt to leave during that time. So 7 o'clock to 7:30, I will have some sessions on vectors and 3D as well. If you want to be a part CBSE people, you are most welcome, but that will not be there for your board exam. So there is a slight difference in the chapters for ISC people and CBSE people. So especially for our ISC friends, I'll be keeping the last half an hour for vectors and 3D. CBSE doesn't have vectors, right? In the board exam. Yeah, they don't have vector and 3D. They don't have, only ISC people have. Okay. So don't worry, Prakul and Raghav, you can, you know, last 15, 20 minutes, maybe we can keep it for that. In fact, vectors, everybody can participate because you have already done vectors in our regular session also. Okay. 3D probably you will not be able to do many questions. Okay. So thank you so much. I hope you learned many things today, whatever you had forgotten or missed out, slipped out of your mind, all those things got recalled. Oh, what happened?